So, good afternoon, everyone. And it feels nice that at the end of 1 year of completing this fellowship, we are finally here to present about whatever little work or the project that we could do after all the learnings from this fellowship. So, I'll start my presentation now. The name of my project is Ration to the Workers of Delhi. So, Nikita, next slide, please.
Just a second. It's not going to the next slide. Give me a second. I'll just reshare it. Here it is. Yes.
Yes, so as we know that during the pandemic, the migrant laborers of our country were really hard hit in economic and social, in several economic and social factors. So I was in Delhi during the second wave of COVID, and after the first wave was over, I actually wanted to explore this area of how the migrant laborers or laborers of our country are being impacted this time again, because it was already hard for them the previous year economically, and how they're coping in this, how did they cope this year, or how they're like, how did they have to face issues again this year? That was what was my interest area to explore this time. So as we know that during the second wave, there was a lot of crunch in the medical facilities available to people. So it was my assumption that if I, conduct participatory interviews with migrant laborers, the need that they will express more is to avail medical facilities. It was my assumption that these socioeconomic groups will be more impacted by COVID this time, and they would need more medical facilities or help therein. But as I conducted interviews with I think 50 migrant laborers from rural urban areas and 50 from rural areas, in order to draw out what they think is their basic necessity at this point during the second wave of pandemic. And I was actually quite surprised to know that it was not medical assistance that they needed. Rather, it was their basic food, meals of 2 times. That was what they felt is lacking majorly during that period of time. So I decided to carry on my project to resolve the issue of food insecurity that was very much prevalent in the daily wage workers or migrant workers of Delhi. So Nikita, next slide. Thank you. So I took 50 sample. I'm sorry, I took 100 sample size from 3 communities of Delhi, Azadpur, Wazirpur, and Sangam Vihar. So how I got this, how I got the opportunity or the way or the contact details to talk to these daily wage workers of Delhi was that there were already a few batchmates of mine who had been exploring this issue of food insecurity among daily wage workers in Delhi. So I kind of wanted to I want myself wanted to be a part of this something an initiative which looks into the food insecurity part of these people. So I took their support, and I conducted interviews with these people in Delhi. And the next slide will present the like sample ratio of rural areas. So I got the chance to interview daily wage workers from MP and Uttar Pradesh. And as we can see that the daily wage workers who majorly went out of the villages to come to cities to work are majorly male. So the gender ratio is more skewed here than it was seen in the rural, I mean, sorry, the urban areas. So the analysis that I got from these participatory interviews are shown here. So the basic point was that there was loss of livelihood for daily wage laborers or migrant laborers, whether it was in urban communities or rural communities. People in urban communities had expressed that like they had some savings of their own, but it had already been exhausted. And the rural community during rural communities, their major struggle was as their workplaces had come locked, they had been closed up during the lockdown. So their major problem was that they had no place to work or earn or safely continue staying in the cities. So their major priority was to come back to their hometown. So along with the loss of livelihood, food insecurity was a very common associated factor which was seen in both the spaces. So the daily wage workers in Delhi, they said that they are buying food on loan, so they are somehow managing to buy food to sustain every day, and they are taking it on loan or on debt. So it's kind of adding on to their future economic burden as well. In the rural areas, what I got to know is that the people who have ration cards of their rural areas, so their families were able to avail food from the PDS system, but who were sitting in staying in the cities at that time, they had faced major food insecurity while they were in the cities to which they had migrated. So they preferred to come back. Another observation was that the people who were in Delhi during the lockdown, they preferred to stay in Delhi. They did not go back. Most of them stayed alone without their families. So they preferred staying in Delhi because they thought that even if there is some kind of minimal work that is available, even which gives them 50 rupees or 40 rupees a day, that will be enough for them to sustain at least. And in rural communities, majorly like they thought that it's better to come back because if not anything, they have some kind of agricultural produce in their village. So they can at least the part of food insecurity or the shortage of food can be met if they come back to their home. So so this is a major observation, ration procurement from PDS. So the challenge what the daily wage laborers of Delhi faced was that maximum of them did not have ration card of Delhi, so that was firstly the major barrier due to which they could not avail food from PDS. So, and also they were majorly in search of any daily work that they could get. So even for them, even when the Delhi government had started making ways to give them ration, even by submitting Aadhaar card, even if they did not have ration card of Delhi or anything, they did not take the liberty to go there because they felt that it's more important to search for work. So that is a major challenge they faced because the government institution was not accessible to them for various reasons. In rural communities, however, their families had ration cards of their villages and they could at least avail the PDS services from there. Nikita, next slide. Okay, so that is the reason that I majorly focused on the focus of the project was to start a ration distribution drive for the migrant laborers or the daily wage laborers in Delhi in two communities, Azadpur and Wazirpur. So the main, the first step that I thought was to, I had to raise funds for it, to buy the kits and for the distribution as well. And the basic aim was to reach at least an average of 20 to 25 people every day. And I continued the distribution drive for 7 days, not continuously, but in this entire span of project execution, it was for a span of 7 days. Next slide, please. Thank you. So how the project implementation started was, when it was quite clear that, there were many initiatives, many other student initiatives and organizations which were already, by the time I wanted to take up this campaign of ration distribution, there were already many organizations and initiatives which were working on the same front. But even after that, when I interviewed the workers there, they said that they still are facing economic crunch and they are still facing food insecurity. So I thought that it's not saturated. It's not that just because a lot of people have already worked in this field, I cannot do something more. There is still a need and there's still an issue in the same, arena. So for the first, how I started was that there was an initiative of some of my batchmates and friends from Delhi University itself who were working previously for ration distribution drives in the communities of Azadpur. And they were, since our fieldwork was also in the adjoining communities of Azadpur and in Azadpur, there were also NGOs and organizations with whom we can get in touch with in case we wanted to, take up any such distribution drive. So that is what I did. I talked to my batchmates who had been involved in ration distribution drives, and I talked to the NGOs which would connect me to the the local informal leaders and the workers union leaders who could at least get me in touch with the people who are in need of ration kits, who were in need of ration kits at that point of time. So the initial stage was this, that I had to meet with all these stakeholders, and we had to the first thing was that we had to talk to the workers union leaders, which was majorly important because they're part of the community whom we wanted to carry on the drive. So through them we got to know, through them we also interacted with some other people in the community. And then we decided that what exactly is there need, what kind of kit content is going to suffice them, what is the date and time on which we can carry out these drives, and what will be convenient for them. So after getting all these details from them, that what do they want in the ration kit, we made up all the framing of budgeting and how much funding we would require. So for that, I started crowdfunding from my personal social circle, and I also took help from the initiative that was already being carried out by my friends. So after that, after the entire budgeting part was done, it took a major time of the project to actually raise funds. So as the funds were coming in, according to that, we were planning when the next or when the distribution drive can take place. So for that, there were meetings with the community people, the union workers, and at times the NGO representatives. So we decided what time will be and what is the venue when the distribution can take place. And we had a count of 20 to 25 people every day for whom we could arrange kits. And the name was written and who will come to receive it was written there. And the drives were planned and executed accordingly. So for the same, for this entire procurement of kits and everything, we talked to a wholesaler in the near the community as well, who, as it was more feasible for all of us to carry the things from there and then accordingly distribute it as well. So the major focus of this project was to make it. There were a lot of stakeholders involved, so it was important to function and work with all of them in a cohesive manner. And as I said, that there were already a lot of initiatives going on in the similar field of food insecurity and to address it. So to convince people that there is still a need for food distribution drives at this point, and that that we can work together to at least adhere to the people to whom the outreach has not yet been provided. So that was a major learning, how to come together with different stakeholders and convince them about the work that I want to do. And then gradually collecting funds was a big challenge, but thankfully I had my friends who had some funds and other people who had contributed to it, understanding the need of the situation. And thanks to that, I could carry out the drive. And so outcome of the project was that whatever objective we had, that we at least should, at an average for 6 to 7 days, we should meet 20 to 25 people to whom we can distribute ration kits. And I could reach to a number of an average of 175 laborers in Azadpur and Wazirpur at the end of 7 days. And yes, it's as I was saying, that it was a collaborative effort with all many stakeholders who had contributed their parts in helping me reach out to these people, talk to them, and understand how and where it can be, it will be more feasible to conduct the distribution drives. So that is how it was. Thank you.
Will you like to briefly share about your experiences in general with the Fang Fellowship?
Okay, about the fellowship or about
Yeah.
the project? About
About
the
the
fellowship.
fellowship
Okay,
in
so.
general, or about doing the project?
Okay, so firstly, I joined Priya Fellowship because, you know, we have in social work. So I have done my master's in social work from Delhi School of Social Work, Delhi University. So whatever we studied in our first year about PRA, about participatory social practices. So I thought that this fellowship will give me a platform to practice that in practical, you know, to learn how to do it, to learn how to actually be participatory. So it's not about just, you know, going and asking for some data and coming back and then using it for our own benefits. It's about how we go out there, we make the community or the people we want to work with are, you know, a participant and a co-traveler in the process of that. So that is something that is a major takeaway from this fellowship. Even, you know, the technical aspects that were shared in the fellowship, like stakeholder analysis, how to understand which stakeholder is important in what situation. Even this has been a major help while conducting this project as well. Also, I mean, when to be very, I mean, frank and honest, it's you know, being participatory is also very challenging because you expect certain kind of responses from certain stakeholders or participants and you may not get it. So, you know, it also helps you to understand the dynamics, you know, what are the inhibitions, why people may not want to support and all of those things. So that, and also it makes you resilient, you know, because in the social sector, this is what we will face. It will always not be very rosy, and there will always not be people who support us. So this has been a major takeaway that yes, there will be challenges, and it's obvious, but then yes, we are supposed to surpass that if we want to do what we actually want to do. So yes, that has been a major takeaway.